like to do it. I'm just gonna next to you. I'm just gonna say an answer for me. So the final presentation will be for you from our travel games on August from Georgia. Audio specialist at Microsoft working on the Microsoft AR project. This is her first conference presentation, so let's give her a giant round of applause.
Thank you so much
for being here.
Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for coming to my talk. Thank you, Sally, Linda, and Brian for having me here. This is my first conference talk, as I said, and I'm really thrilled to be here. And I might make some mistakes, but let me know if I'm talking too fast, which is what happens. So this talk is called Minecraft Through a New Lens, Recontextualizing Audio for Mobile AR. And this talk will be essentially about my experience while working on Minecraft. So before we dig into this talk, let me give you a brief information about myself. I'm Shani Jang, audio specialist at Minecraft team. I was previously a composer, sound designer, and Nintendo software technology. I worked on things like Super Mario Maker for 3DS and Super Mario Plus, doing some music arrangements and sound effects. I'm a graduate from DigiPen Institute of Technology, and I integrated content. Yeah. So what we'll talk about? We're going to talk about three things. Before that, I wanted to ask, how many of you have played Minecraft? Yay! So when I'm gonna try not to speak micro-specific term in case you don't know, but when I say vanilla Minecraft, we're talking about original Minecraft creatures. And when I say mobs, I'm talking about all the non-player creatures, like sheep, all the barnyard animals, or zombie creepers. So first we're going to talk about designing with intentions, the high-level considerations. For this topic, we'll go over what major points I have to consider and keep in mind to design soundscape for this game. Before I design anything, I need to understand how the game is structured, what the focuses are, and what the challenges are. Secondly, I'm going to talk about unique solutions for unique problems. Here, with the things that I discussed in the first point in mind, I'll go over what unique challenges we have for this game and how we came up with the solutions. Three, the lessons I learned. Before I get into these details, I should tell you that this talk is not a technical talk for AR. It doesn't focus on any aspect of certain part of audio either. This is more like a summary of my thought process to go over some main design points, and challenges I had, and solutions I came up with. And I'm not giving any answers or rules for designing mobile AR audio. What I hope is that you see my process, how my process was like, and hopefully I can provide some interesting things to talk about. And if there are better ways, you can always make suggestions for me, and maybe you can apply those ideas for your future. But first, what is Minecraft Earth? Well, here's a trailer.
Sometimes life requires thinking outside the box. Thank you.
today both on Android and iOS. We're currently rolling out early access for more and more countries, so you'll be able to download the game as your country is announced. I think America's not announced yet. It's coming. A little more in depth, we have four main game modes. The first one is location-based exploration and resource collection with real time. Don't do annoying. I think that's actually a book from Marty.
Yeah.
I know that a lot of people mute their speakers when they're playing mobile games. But if they do have their speaker on, what do they want to hear, right? What do they care about and what do they not care about? I need to keep the soundscape to be not only ambient and relaxing, but also very informative to the players so they want to keep hearing sounds. Now let's talk about the mobile AR aspects. Does AR always mean cutting-edge technology for audio? Should I consider using HRTF? In case you don't know what HRTF is, it refers to head-related transfer functions. It's having power of our two ears perceive sound in space. Anyway, well, first of all, this game is not the best experience with headphones. This is not a wearing headphones is highly recommended kind of game. High-tech spatial audio doesn't really make sense, and it's not the main focus for our game. Like I said in the first point, this game has a very strong social aspect. So you want to talk to your friends while you're playing, and you want to hear your surroundings as you play. Also, we have some platform and technical limitations as well. The memory and CPU limit is not really high on mobile devices. Also, because it is a mobile, players will most likely play with earbuds or a phone speaker, not really with a surround sound system or nice headphones. So, also, even though the sound quality of those earbuds and phone speaker has been improved a lot, we still have some limitations for the frequency range that we use. And of course, because this is AR, augmented reality, not VR, virtual reality, we need to incorporate real-life sounds. And because this is a real-life, multiplayer, mobile AR game, we have to deal with the other player's sounds too, right? We don't have to worry about playing their sounds because it's already being edited from their actual position. So we get the pre-spin spatialization from the real world. So what sounds should you still hear on your speaker? And what sounds do I not have to play from your speaker? Not only that, a very unique aspect of Minecraft is that we deal with different, like Earth, is that we deal with different scales of game in our gameplay. We have a tabletop size gameplay, just like any virtual Lego box to deal with. And we have a full size gameplay where you go into the world and build adventures to mine rewards and get rewards. Another consideration I had in mind was modernizing and scaling the Minecraft aesthetic. This game is still a Minecraft game, but there are a lot of new things to add to it. Visually, the lighting is better, particle effects are very cool, and the animations are more detailed and polished, and there are a lot of variations for each animation as well. So what does that mean sonically? What does it mean for sound effects and out of the music? What things can I make better and newer, and what things should I keep the same? Also, this is a franchise expansion, so I need to think about how I can sonically brand Minecraft franchise and Minecraft Earth. An example I had in mind was Nintendo Switch. As a lot of you will know, Nintendo Switch UI sounds are very cool. It's so well designed, and it represents Nintendo Switch brand really well. And I thought, if Nintendo Switch UI is very snappy and mechanical sounding, I want Minecraft Earth UI sounds to be very floppy, just like you're typing on the thing, and acoustic sound. Also, as much as I want to go crazy and make it super cool and polished and high-res and realistic, Minecraft is not really about being realistic. Everything is a block, and you can hear zombies below you just like it's right next to you. There are no fancy effects. There's barely an occlusion or obstruction happening in the game. We don't really have a typical ambience loop like imaginary winds or birds. So as much as I want the soundscape to be fuller, this is certainly a characteristic of Minecraft I should respect. Lastly, I had to create a pipeline that scales with new projects. With the original system, it was going to be really hard to achieve the audio goal I had for this game. I'll talk more about this later. So with these three main considerations in mind, let's talk about the problems and the solutions. So the first point was about social dialogue and gameplay. Like I said earlier, the gameplay can be very repetitive, happens in a very fast cycle, and can be really long. It's really at all costs. I didn't want the sounds to be annoying. So for music, I kept the same style of implementation as the original Minecraft by giving a playlist of music instead of looping the same soundtrack until the player does something. And each mode has its own playlist. So the map mode has its own playlist of music, and build mode, we provide creative mode of Minecraft playlist for build mode. And play mode, we have a survival music tracks that we use for Minecraft, or the playlist of anything. And between each track, we give a randomized delay, so that there's some silence, randomized silence. And for sound effects, I have to pay attention to how often a certain type of sound effects were played. For example, every time you tap on the tappable, you're rewarded with items. And each item revealed has a celebration sound that was tied to its rarity. And each rarity celebration had to sound very unique so the player can associate the sound with the rarity. Since this is a very short musical stinger, I simply just transposed in whole steps and made 5 variations for each rarity. There's also some long sounds that are repeated as well. In adventures, we have puzzle failure or puzzle success sounds, or we have some dramatic music cues when suddenly the monsters spawn in front of you. In those cases, I keep the same instrumentation, but compose a very different phrase that is rhythmically or harmonically different. So the main focus for these variations was to keep them sound similar enough that the player can learn it and associate the sound with a certain event, but it's different enough that it's not really tied into the course. Also, this is multiplayer in real life. If you're playing with your friends, you'll probably be hearing the sound on the speaker, not from your earbuds, because you want to hear your friends. This means that fancy spatial audio won't really make a difference, because everything will be coming out from almost mono speaker. Another reason not to worry about HRTL. Yes, not only that, you get free spatialization from your friends. Nothing can be real life spatialization. So we take advantage of this, and we don't play third person, play character sounds like when your friends eat or when your friends get damaged. We don't play those sounds because we're going to hear it. So because of all this, the master output from my AFCON project is a lie. This is a graph of Minecraft Earth bus structure. So we have some UI sounds like button elements and musical stingers. We have some map sounds like imaginary winds and birds that are provided. We have some tappable sounds. And we have all the AR sounds like mobs, blocks, player, of Minecraft original sounds. And then we have a playlist of music. It all goes to my FMOD output, master output. But that is not it, because I have to deal with my friend's phone and all these crazy city sounds that we always hear. And then all of that gets mixed together and then goes to the player's ears. So that's why the master output. So what are some unique problems and challenges I have specifically for being mobile? For this game, we had a unique challenge to set attenuations for 3D sounds. On a macro level, we have a different scale of gameplay. There are two main scales. In the play mode and adventures, everything is full size. They're basically the same size as the Minecraft player from the original Minecraft. However, in the build mode, everything is tiny, like Lego blocks. You're like a giant person looking everything, overseeing everything. So originally we tried keeping the attenuation the same as normal Minecraft, but there was a problem. The attenuation was set using blocks in original Minecraft. So the volume property, when the volume property is 1, it means you can hear the sounds until you're 6 blocks away. So after 6 blocks away, when you're on the 7th block, the sounds just cuts off. So I don't know how that decision was made, but I needed to redesign the titration settings for each object in the original bootmap as well. But even that was not enough, because using full-size attenuation settings for the billabong, when you're a giant, that didn't really work because you have to get pretty close to hear the whole sounds. So I had to create a second settings for the billabong. But even the billabong size differs depending on the size. For example, the 4x4 billabong, the block is a little bigger than when you have a 32x32 billabong. And the design team was, they're still in process developing different scales of AR gameplay, the brainstorming, like adjusting scales and making different modes. So I need to keep that in mind as well. So this is what I did. The event doesn't play an asset directly. This parent event doesn't have any tracks with the actual assets. There's no attenuation settings either. Instead, the each event has the RTPC main scale, and when the scale parameter value is a 10, it triggers a tabletop mode parent, I mean the nested event, and when the value is set to 20, it triggers a reference event tabletop. So the reason why I have this empty spaces in between is because I need to leave room for the different possible scales that designers can. So inside the nested event, you'll see the actual sounds. This is the nested event for digging grass in full size. So in full size, one block is about 0.75 meter. So it's like this big. So the sound starts attenuating from 2.25 meters. So it's like from here to over here. And around 22.5 meter, it's like a lot farther than that, I think, the sound will be at the maximum attenuation. And this is the same sound, but in a tabletop mode. So in tabletop mode, one block is about 0.07 meters. So it's really tiny. So about 0.28 meter, the sound starts attenuating. And around 4.9 meter, the volume will be at the maximum attenuation. So that's the difference in macro level, but tabletop, so in macro level, tabletop and full size, they have their own attenuation settings. But not all the sounds have the same attenuation settings for tabletop and scale. Just like typical games, some sounds should be heard even when you're far away, and some sounds are only audible when you're pretty close to it. So prioritizing sounds was really important for this game. Because of two main reasons. One reason is that the build and play mode is almost like a sandbox game. For example, you can build an animal farm with hundreds of animals. There can be so many sounds happening and in this tiny chunk of Minecraft. So I need to control the sounds. And the second reason is that you can build for hours and hours, but the variation we have for idle sounds and ambient sounds are pretty limited. Idle sounds are like 2 to 3 packages. And again, the audio should be annoying. So because of these two reasons, and to divide the sounds into different categories and prioritize them for better focus and importance. So these are the main several categories of sounds in VR mode, AR mode. The leftmost is the most important, and the rightmost is the least important. So the player sounds, like when you take a damage or when you eat, they're the most important sounds, no questions. So these are played in 2D. They're really nice and loud, and then we have attenuated depending on the distance. And UI sounds and visible stimulus are equally important. So because we have UI sounds in the AR mode, is like we have a feedback sound when you try to place a block or a mob in an invalid space. And we have some music cues to guide the players in adventures. So these sounds shouldn't be compromised in any ways because the direct feedback to their invalid actions are important in gameplay. So I play these sounds in 2D too, and it doesn't get attenuated. And the second tier of sounds is interaction sounds. Some examples on this sound are mining and building, like interactive block sounds. So when you dig, place, or break a block, or open the door, or press a button, you always hear the sound. And these sounds are very important because these are direct feedback to player's action. So even in the build mode, when everything is a small Lego block, and when you're pretty far away, you have to hear the sound quieter, but still you have to hear it because you want to know that you actually placed the block, that you actually broke the block. So the third tier category is hostile mob sounds. The reason why hostile mobs have a higher priority than peaceful mob sounds is because they can harm the players. So they not only serve as an environmental ambience, they also serve as an informative to players. So just like original Minecraft, if there's a skeleton hiding below you or behind you, you want to know because you want to not die. And the fourth tier is the peaceful mob sounds. So even among hostile and peaceful mob sounds, hurt and death sounds for both type of mobs are more important than their idle or elusive sounds or behavioral sounds, and because they serve as a player interaction sound. Because when you hurt or kill the mob, you always want to hear it. And of course, the functional ambience like piston or fireworks explosion are more prioritized than environmental sounds like water and lava. One thing I want to point out is that water and lava sounds in original Minecraft is actually very important because that's how you find a cave, or that's how you know to be very careful when you're digging because you don't want to fall into water, fall into lava and die. But in Minecraft Earth, you cannot really fall into lava or drown in water, so they're the lowest priority for this specific game. So let's look at these two main type of attenuation pairs that are used among this type of sounds. This is the attenuation pair I use for important sounds like player action feedback and informative sound effects. Since you have to hear the sounds pretty clear even when you're far away, I set the minimum distance to be a lot longer. So this makes it so that the sound doesn't attenuate until you reach this minimum distance. And after minimum distance, the sound starts attenuating using the curve I assigned in the clock. And when it reaches to the maximum distance value, the volume after the attenuation is still off. However, for less important sounds, such as peaceful mob idle, booster sounds, and looping sound effects, they have a smaller minimum distance, so it starts attenuating at a shorter distance. And the instant limit for these sounds are a lot higher to prevent any excessive amount of ghosts. So I spent a lot of time scribbling notes and drawing things, but that doesn't really make anything perfect. Real-time profiling and tuning was really important to get these things right. So I play-tested a lot. And for buildable, the Lego tabletop size, I tested by placing a block and getting further and further away until I can actually place the block where I want. And I made sure that the sound is quieter, but you can still hear it. For play mode, I kept things pretty similar to the original Minecraft in the real world, except for the fact that after 6 blocks, the sound doesn't come up. So another thing I had to deal with was considering the AR aspect of the game was the real world sounds. In augmented reality, the real world is the ambience. Unlike virtual reality, we cannot take players away from the real world. Instead, we enhance the real world's ambience by adding an extra layer, just like an augmented ambience for augmented reality. So in that mode, you're not fully in the AR mode where your camera shows your surroundings on top of many reality things. When you look at the map, it has the same geography as the real world, but the vibe is totally different. So that's like downtown Seattle picture. You can see the pier. The sky is blue, it's sunny, and Express is everywhere. I know the Seattle is not. So whenever players explore to collect tackles, I wanted them to feel relaxing and I wanted them to feel like they're walking aggressive instead of dirty. That's why in the map hub, I have a layer of imaginary winds and birds on top of as an automatic. However, in the AR mode, the chunk of Minecraft is seen on top of your reality and your surroundings. So it would feel weird if I put imaginary birds or winds, especially if you're playing inside or when you're playing rainy, dark place. I cannot really guess what kind of ambience you need. So instead, the game in-game sounds like mobs, water, lava, they naturally fill in the space to form. Now let's move on to the last point, scaling and modernism. So I mentioned earlier that I wanted this game to have a modern Minecraft aesthetic. And again, Minecraft is not about being realistic. There are no footsteps reaches, there are no environmental effects that you can bring. I had to stay on this non-realistic brand but deliver a newer experience. So I had to establish music. So here's a diagram that shows what things exist in original Minecraft and what I chose to keep in the middle and what I'm adding on top of it to make it feel like I'm different. So the animation sounds are not really synced to animation itself because we don't really have good animations in original Minecraft. They just walk, eat, that's it. And we have very minimal UI sounds. A lot of the buttons don't really make sounds, and we only have one type of click sound for some important buttons. And the attenuation curves are not really set as well. The sounds are really hard to cut after certain ones. So those I didn't want to keep for sure. But yeah, I wanted to keep the surface neutral footsteps. So each mob has this one type of footstep we use for all the surface, and I wanted to keep that. And I wanted to keep the acoustic sounding timbre of the UI sounds. And on top of it, I wanted to have some environmental ambience like winds and birds. And I wanted to sync animation sounds to actual animations. And I wanted more variations for new mobs. We have interesting mobs like Muddy Pig, who likes to swim in mud. And we have Clutchroom, who likes to run to a dark place and and yeah, I wanted more variations for them because they actually have really detailed animations. And I wanted more detailed UI sounds for the player actions. For example, when you press a craft button, I wanted the crafting sounds to be played so it feels like you're crafting. And for smelting button, I wanted those to have some fire sounds to represent your action. And I wanted to have some musical sound effects for celebration. Now what about music? C418's music, he's a composer from Germany. His music has been used for Minecraft for a long time. We wanted to keep using some original music so the player instantly have this nostalgia to original Minecraft. But we wanted to introduce new music that represents the specific game. Since we're blending both original and new music, my main goal for music was to keep the same style, but introducing something new. So let's talk about the main aspect of Minecraft music for a moment. Here's a short sample of the original music. Thank you.
Thank you.
And it moves really slow, so you might, you know, look in the door and you're just like looking at the screen. But that's kind of my intention because I don't want the music to drive the motion too fast. So you're going to be playing this game for a long time, just walking around with your friends. And it's just act like the ambient music. And you'll hear some oscillator patterns, but in an acoustic piano instead of on synthesis. And you'll hear the cello, that's acoustic instrument. And I'm using solo piano for my game mapping. And you'll hear some more acoustic sounding, but still synthesis. So, as I mentioned earlier in this presentation, it was going to be very difficult to achieve my audio goal for this game with the original system we're using for Asian Impact. And before I joined this team, they didn't have any audio person. So creating an audio pipeline that scales with this Minecraft Earth was my main focus when I joined the team. Let's talk about the original Minecraft's features and tools for me. The original Minecraft is built on custom engine and uses FMAP low-level API. All of the audio files were stored as FSV files and everything was handled in JSON files and game notes. And again, there were no functionality to loop, there were no functionality to actually loop the sound and stop the sounds. So first of all, I knew that I had to somehow request an audio tool to be built, so I have more control. Or I have to convince the team to integrate some kind of new effect. Also, since we use the entire vanilla Minecraft, original Minecraft gameplay in the AR mode, I needed them to be included in my same hierarchy of sounds for Minecraft. Luckily, they're too busy to build any custom tools for me, and luckily, we're already using low-level FMAP API, so we can keep the game codes the same. So I convinced the team to integrate FMAP Studio. And I imported all the vanilla sounds into my project file, so everything could be under the same hierarchy, and I could also assign attenuation for different scale for different types of sounds. This was a huge upgrade for us. And since we're doing a lot of detailed animations for mob variants like mud pigs and plutrium, we absolutely needed an ability to sync animation sounds to the actual animation. And that was a huge step forward from the original Minecraft, and that really helped me design more detailed animation sounds. Establishing audio team and advocating for audio. I feel like this is a challenge in a lot of the teams and companies, especially when you're the only audio person. When I started, I didn't have a project manager for audio, so I kept not being notified about important dates or important changes to animation being played. Also, the test people didn't have any structure to test audio, so it took too much time to find any audio bugs. I was the only one finding audio bugs. And at that time, they thought audio was polished. So I had to keep reminding people that audio is not polished, people. No, artists, designers, programmers, we all work together to put this feature in the game. And audio is not on top of the feature. It should be part of creating this feature and then put it in the game. So it took a while to establish this with my team. So I asked the design project manager to be audio project manager as well. And now the missing audio is now a blocker from shipping any build. So you cannot ship a build when some audio is missing. Yes. And I have a programmer I work pretty closely to develop a custom audio feature. And because the dev had different levels of experience for implementing audio, I should always be as clear as I can be. Assuming how the game engine takes care of audio things and how the devs will implement audio, that was really dangerous for me. For example, when you're using Unity or Unreal, when you attach the sound to game logic, the position is being updated just automatically, but that doesn't just automatically happen in our game engine. So it was really crucial to explain every single detail of where the sound should be attached to and how it should be updated and behave. and what things I'm handling at the studio, so they will arrive and change the item. Yeah, so what did I learn? Of course, I learned a lot of things, but I wanted to keep out, put out only some important things. So don't get caught up on the cutting edge. This was the most important lesson I learned. Now, when I first joined this team, they didn't tell me that this was an AR project. I knew on the first day of the job, and I freaked out because this is AR Minecraft? Wait, is this AR? You didn't test me about any AR or VR knowledge, you know? Like, do I have to like study all the ambisonics? Oh my goodness, I'm gonna be so busy studying. But you know, you don't really have to think about all this technology first. You start with the end goal. You know, what do you want your players to experience? What should they feel and how should they experience this game? So you start with this end goal, and then you choose technologies you need, and then use that technology to achieve your goal. You need to figure out about the technology. And what works is the best. No, you don't always have to use all this new technology. If the old way works, that's the best thing for you. You don't always have to try to do more complicated things. And I learned a lot about how to advocate for audio. No, don't try to explain. Just show them what you visualize, because you're such a people. You're very visually oriented. And make them fall in love. This was a lesson that Becky Allen actually told me when she was on a podcast with Guy Whitmore. She told me a story that they had this audio thing they really wanted to put in the game, and the game team didn't understand what they were explaining. So instead of trying to keep like explaining what you want to do, Guy Whitmore actually made a very beautiful demo, nice visual, and he just showed it to the team, and the team fell in love with it, and they really wanted to have that in the game because they just loved it. So that's what I did with the music, instead of just trying to explain, you know, we need new music for this, and we need ostinato or acoustic, they're not gonna care. So I just recorded my phone and made an actual gameplay video, and with the fake map ambience, and then I just have them experience what it feels like, and then they're like, okay, maybe we're gonna do new music for this. That's how I convinced the team to do new music for this. So these are my main two things that I learned, and that was my thought process for this game. It's still early access, so we have a lot of things that we haven't shown and we haven't announced. There are a lot more to show, so I hope you enjoyed my talk.
Thank you.